Back, my dear light bulbs, to another review of Tokyo Ghoul Re. So in this chapter, a lot of things happen. The first point I want to talk about is Kaneki's rational side, and it's actually manifested in a ghoul, which is Tsuyama, where Tsuyama is explaining to him, yes, you could be peaceful and stuff, but it gets to a point where peace might not work. And that is true, like, his people are starving and stuff like that, which I'm going to talk about later on in this review. And Tsuyama is just bringing up critical points, and Kaneki, he has this optimistic mindset that is way too optimistic, where he's just like, it's going to be fine. Even if I'm gone, basically somebody will take over and ghouls and humans will coexist with each other, basically. And there's a lot of problems with Kaneki's plan, which I'm going to put that discussion I made in the description below, so check that out. I talked about the flaws of Kaneki's plan and stuff. And basically, we got death flags for Kaneki in this chapter, so Kaneki might eventually die. The second point I want to talk about is Ko, and how I still don't think he is a old guy squad member, a CCG spy, or anything like that. I think he's a regular ghoul. The panels where we see Ko actually watching Kaneki, like, speak, like, his eyes are, like, right open, like, he's just looking so, like, he's analyzing Kaneki, like, all of what he's saying, his movements, his characteristics, and probably in Ko's mind, we don't know yet, Ko's probably like, should I follow this leader? Is what he's preaching true and stuff like that? And that's what I think Ko is thus far. I believe he's going to be the heir to Kaneki. A lot of people believe that as well. I don't think he's a spy. I don't think he's a CCG agent. I don't think he's any of that. I think he's just a regular ghoul. He's probably an orphan or whatever. And he just wants to look up to somebody. Look up to somebody that is fighting for his people, the ghouls. Even though Kaneki's a half ghoul, Kaneki's still a ghoul in the end. He's still got some parts of him that are ghoul-like, like his Kagune and stuff like that. All right. The third point I want to talk about is a very interesting one. Is Kaneki a good king? So far in the story, I do not think Kaneki is a good king. I know a lot of people may disagree with me, but hear me out. First thing, how can you be a king if you can't even supply food for your people? I know Kaneki's not trying to kill humans. I know he's trying to do things peacefully so humans don't fear him. But if his people are starving, and he's starving himself, which that weakens ghouls if they start starving and stuff, and they get desperate and they have hallucinations and, you know, they die in the end. They go crazy if they're starving. That's not a good thing. That's not a good image on Kaneki, on the people's view of Kaneki and stuff like that, because a king is supposed to supply at least food for his people. I know the ghouls right now are following Kaneki blindly. They're like, my king, but it gets to a point where even Kaneki made a reference to all the ribs and stuff, them playing with their ribs. Like, that's really messed up. Like, Kaneki at least should try to find some form of food. I don't know. He does not want to kill humans. And there's no suicide victims around to gather the bodies or whatever. And it's just getting serious. Like, it will get to a point if Kaneki does not get them above ground, does not get them food, that even the most loyal followers will turn their backs on him. Like, I'm not talking about Tsuyama. Like, Tsuyama, I don't think he will ever do that. But, like, I'm talking about the regular ghouls that are praising him, that are chanting his name. Well, not his name, chanting king, king, my king, and stuff like that. Because if you live under a king and you're starving every day, eventually you will lose hope in that king or in that figure that you believe they will bring you to that promised land. Okay, the next point I want to talk about is what Furuta said. Talking about a dragon, that it could one-shot a lot of things. So that was a One Punch Man reference. And a lot of people are looking deep into this and stuff like that. But I'm not going to do any of that, because right after he says that, right, there's a panel right under with the first generation Queen's Quad, with Uri, Mutsuki, and Saiko. And I don't think Sui Ishida just put that little panel right under, after Furuta says dragon, right under for no reason. Like, that doesn't make any type of sense. The dragon is basically Uri, Mutsuki, and Psycho, and they're supposed to represent a three-headed dragon because, like, their heads were, like separated into three little small panels. They're the three-headed dragons, and together they form the dragon. Separate, not together, they form a dragon that's very powerful and could probably take on any adversary. So that's who I think dragon is. I know a lot of people probably who read this chapter may not have gotten that because they either read the chapter too early or they had to reread the chapter a couple of times, but that's the most logical choice in my opinion. And I know a lot of people may be like, oh, you're not looking too deeply into it. That's not good. Sometimes you don't have to look too deeply into it. The mangaka sometimes gives us the hints right there and there. Like in last week's chapter, a lot of people are like, I don't know if the Nameless King is Kaneki. Who else would it be? Like, it's not going to be Amon. The ghouls don't even know who the heck Amon is. They know the One-Eyed King. The Ken Kaneki basically is their king, and that's it. They haven't seen Amon in no leadership role, so there's no way it was going to be Amon or Hide. Why would the ghouls follow Hide? Like, no, like, that didn't make sense. The most logical choice was Kaneki, and that's what happened. I'm not going to really go too in-depth about Toka and the pregnancy test. We have speculated that Toka's pregnant. She probably is pregnant. And that brings me to my next and final point where... Oh, wait. I got two more. Another point after that. So, Kaneki, he wants to help ghouls. He wants ghouls to coexist with humans. He don't want humans to fear ghouls anymore. And it's like he's a false king. He has like a false mask on. And by that, I mean that he's preaching all of this. But in the beginning, when he was talking to Takizawa, he was like, yeah, I'm going to accomplish all these things, but I don't know how. And he gave kind of a smirk, like he didn't really care about this goal or whatever. But now that he's probably has a child on the way, he's like, yes, I'm going to help ghouls. Like, it's like he's a false king because in the beginning with his goals and ambitions, he wasn't really serious about it, but now that he's going to probably have a child on the way, he's more serious about it because he wants to protect his child, and that just shows greed. Like, in the beginning, he didn't really have anything. He did have some stuff to protect, but having a child means more to Kaneki than really protecting the everyday ghoul, like, because that's going to be Kaneki's child, and it's like, he's like a selfish king, is what I'm trying to say. Now, the last thing is Hayato finding the city underground, the 24th Ward and stuff, the missing city. They travel a long journey to get there. Hopefully, they get food there. And now, the speculation starts where it's just like, are the ghouls in this city, in this underground city, how are they alive? A lot of people in the Tokyo Ghoul Reddit said, how are they alive? How are they getting sunlight and stuff like that? How are they breathing? But Hayato, as he was walking, he was like, there's a breeze coming in that direction, so there's oxygen and air underground there for some way, somehow. But they're not getting sunlight, so the ghouls there might look differently. Maybe they can't use their kagunis. Maybe they're more powerful. Who knows? But Kaneki's just banking that these ghouls will help him in his revolution, in his mission to get coexistence between ghouls and humans. Overall, this chapter was really good. We got a lot of information, which I'm happy about. Hope you enjoy this review. I'm gonna give this chapter an 8 out of 10. And if you like this video, like the video. And if you didn't like the video, remember to have a great day. Peace.